All right. Well, hey, everybody. Rob Satcher, Feedback Ranch. I'm here with Mandy Scheller of Own It Accounting. And if you're a business owner, a real estate agent, a life insurance agent, I don't care if you're a construction company, whatever it is, we're going to talk about how do you implement in 2021 and later here, we're going to talk about how do you reduce your taxes. And really what this comes down to is your entity type. We're going to talk about S-Corps. How do you convert to become an S-Corp? How much tax could you share if you become an S-Corp? And we're going to talk about what has happened. There's been two gigantic changes. One of them is that the Tax Cut and Jobs Act came out a couple of years ago, and we have this new qualified income deduction that's a little bit different, and people get really confused. So we're going to hit some of the common sense things of when is an S-Corp a good idea, when is it not a good idea, what kind of tax savings you can have. But just right off the bat, I want to give a shout out to Mandy Scheller, that's who we're here with. She's absolutely fantastic, and she has Own It Accounting. So we want this video to be super helpful. I don't want to spend so much time doing introduction. Mandy and I are going to interrupt each other. We're going to try and add as much stinking value as we possibly can here. But I tell you what, folks, if you are looking to mitigate your taxes, if you own 1099 income, I'm interviewing her here because I help accountants. We do websites and stuff for accountants, bookkeepers. But Mandy knows how to mitigate taxes. Not only that, she's a CPA, she has a master's in accounting, and she absolutely is one of these accountants that I trust 110% to take a small business owner and do what should be done to help them keep more of their net profits, to make their life easy. Like, I hate this stuff. Mandy makes your life easy. So I'm telling you, go to Own It Accounting. So I just want to get this out of the way right now. I am overtly recommending her. There's a handful of accountants like this that I really enjoy. But we're going to just dive right into it. Mandy, when it comes down to real estate agents, small business owners, construction guys, maybe we talk about this real estate example, because there's a lot of real estate agents out there making 100 grand, 200 grand. Real estate's doing well. Help us understand, how do you mitigate taxes, and fill us in.
Sure. You know, one of the biggest questions that I get is what's the difference between an S-Corp and an LLC? And one of the big confusion points behind that is the LLC is your legal status with the state, usually where you reside. And the S-Corp is your tax classification with the IRS. You can be both an LLC and an S-Corp at the same time. So you don't lose that LLC status when you elect to become an S-Corp, but you gain potentially the option to save a significant amount on your payroll taxes. And like you said, the qualified business income deduction, this is a big change that came out with the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act a couple of years ago. And it really complicates things, I should say.
Yeah, yeah. It's like between that and then we were talking about this whole, like, if you do retirement plans, that can complicate it. If you're trying to get a loan for real estate, that can complicate it. But so what you're saying is, long story short, is that there's two sides to it. You have your legal protections, and then you have how you're taxed. There's two different things there. Okay.
So like, let's say you're a real estate agent and you have not filed to become an LLC with the state where you live, and you want protection against your personal assets being taken in the event of a debt or an accident or something like that beyond the scope of your business insurance, you're gonna wanna file an LLC with the state. But if you file an LLC, you're still taxed as a sole proprietor for tax purposes unless you make an S-Corp election with the IRS. You can do that. It's due by March 15th of every year. However, you can get a late election, and usually they will accept the late election with an explanation of why it wasn't submitted by the 15th. And you can kind of retroactively apply that for this year. You can't go back to the prior year, but you can elect it for 2021, even though the March 15th deadline has already passed, with an explanation submitted to the IRS, and they typically will accept those.
But so we're talking about tax savings. You're saying we can jump in. So even though it says this March 15th, chances are, if we have a good reason, try the conversion. Call Mandy and actually try this, because you're going to get excited about how much money you save.
Right. So going back to the QBI deduction, the qualified business income deduction, that complicates things, because if you are an S-Corp and you're taking a salary, that salary is going to reduce your business income and potentially lower your deduction. It's a 20% tax cut for self-employed people. So there's a little bit of this like pendulum where you have to balance it, and you have to figure out, is this S-Corp going to save me on taxes? And there's also another huge caveat, is that reasonable compensation is the number one kind of driver of what will save you money on taxes. And trying to put this into the simplest terms possible, when you make the S-Corp election, if you have $100,000 of profit in your business, if you're a sole proprietor, you pay income tax on 100% of that, and you pay payroll tax on 100% of that. When you become an S-Corp, you pay income tax on 100% of your income, your profit, but you only pay payroll tax on the portion that is your salary. Now, let's say you're a real estate agent. Reasonable compensation for a real estate agent might be anywhere from $30,000 to $50,000, depending on where you live, and the kind of the going rate for a real estate professional in your area. But if you are a surgeon, you know, you might not be able to get away with doing $40,000 as your salary. You're going to need to bump that a lot higher.
Mm-hmm. So for dummies, I just want to look at something because I am so slow. So what you're saying is, let's just imagine I was making $95,000.
Right.
I would owe this 15.3%. So I got this Social Security tax and kind of a Medicare tax. So long story short, I'm owing 15.3% in self-employment tax. And this is not income tax. This is not state income or federal income tax. That's a whole other conversation.
It's on top of your normal taxes.
And this is if I'm an LLC, if I just make money and I haven't become an S-Corp, I'm going to take my net profit and I'm going to owe 15.3% basically on the net profit. But right. What you're saying is
a little deduction for the employer portion, but give or take, this is a great way to look at it.
So here's another simple. So the idea here, we make the same amount of money, but if we were to become an S-Corp, long story short, we'd be taking a reasonable salary, which is this rule. Basically, people are paying themselves from the corporation using a payroll, and there's a bunch of rules to this. But like in this simple example, I think we did kind of a simple split. Here, instead of paying 14 grand in taxes, we're paying about half that in self-employment taxes. So and this is just top level. Basically, we've cut our taxes in half is what you're saying. But
right.
The ability
to... Do you know what the reasonable salary is on that calculation, Rob?
I don't remember what we did. I think it was about half.
Maybe, yeah. And that would be reasonable depending on the industry that the self-employed person is in.
So help us understand. Okay, so there's this. So what's this tension at play within an S-Corp? It's like you become this S-Corp, you convert, but right. What do you actually have to do? What's the decision and what's the bureaucracy that needs to get like sure. addressed as you're doing it?
So the kind of the difference between being an LLC and being an LLC taxed as an S-Corp is now you have a couple of layers of added complexity. The first one is your accounting fees are going to go up. You now have to file an 1120S tax return. And depending on which CPA you talk to, that could cost you, you know, $2,500, could cost you $1,000 extra. The prices vary. And it depends on the complexity of your corporation too. So you have that extra tax return instead of just reporting it on your individual income tax return. Now you have corporate and individual. Secondly, you need to keep track of your books, preferably every single month, so that you are able to estimate your taxes and pay yourself a reasonable salary throughout the year. So that's a little bit of a, so you've got both bookkeeping and payroll obligations that you need to take care of. This works really well when you have existing employees that you're already paying on a payroll system and you just are throwing yourself into the mix. But if you are if you're a solopreneur and you need to pay yourself, you're gonna have to go get a payroll system or hire somebody to manually file these quarterly payroll tax returns and unemployment tax returns. And you know, you've got an annual federal unemployment tax that you have to pay. So there's a little bit of trade-off. You've got unemployment taxes added, you've got payroll system fees added, you've got a bookkeeping system fee added, and you've got to pay an accountant to do all of this for you, or you got to figure out how to do it all yourself, which mm-hmm. I don't recommend. We've seen a lot of business owners run into problems where they're not paying themselves the right kind of salary. They're not paying themselves the right amount. They're not paying themselves at all. That's a big problem that I see. And it's not okay to make the S-Corp election and then just not pay yourself a salary, because you've got to pay in something to that Social Security and Medicare tax. Otherwise, you're going to get into big hot water with the IRS. But if you can throw your situation into a scenario analysis, which a good CPA should be able to do this for you, you can look at your tax scenario. They might be able to take last year's tax return and last year's books and run it through. What is it going to look like if I have an S-Corp with the added accounting fees, with the added QBI deduction? What's the net tax savings? And then you're going to have, you know, what's the net tax savings if I stay a single member LLC or a partnership or whatever it is that you currently are? And a lot of times, it'll,
what's curious to me, real quick. So one of the things that I see is that, you know, oftentimes we'll start out talking with people. This is back when I was at our firm that we worked together. And even as I watch folks like you, you know, tax savings is an interesting thing. No matter what, as a business grows, you got to have an accountant. Because let's just be frank. Your books are probably wrong. If you're just a regular Joe and you're in your own bookkeeping and you're trying to do it, I guarantee you there are cobwebs, spider webs, things folded backwards, upside down. You are doing stupid things that not only are opening you up to risk, but I guarantee you, you're missing opportunity. Like, that's what I always told people.
I'm going to interrupt you real quick. How do you know how much to pay yourself every month if you're not keeping track of your income and expenses? That's something I ask a lot of my clients. Like, if you're paying yourself a huge huge distributions every month, if you're taking, you know, $2,000 a month out, but you're not making $2,000 a month, you are slowly eating away at the equity in your business. And so that's just a whole other can of worms, and we won't get into too much detail with that. But keeping track of your income and expenses every month, one, is just really important as a business owner. That is what's going to take you to the next level to become the executive that your business needs. All executives know how to read financial statements, interpret them, and make decisions from them. If you want to level up your business, if you want to scale and grow your business, that is numero uno. And then the tax savings from the S corp, I would say, is number two. But they go hand in hand. So if you're trying to DIY all of this stuff, definitely at least get a proposal and see if becoming an S corp makes sense for you, because you're going to get that added benefit of having timely, relevant financial statements every single month that you can use to make decisions and actually grow your business as a side effect.
And not waste your time. Because let's be frank, one of the things that I've been finding, you know, when you start a business, it's like you'll do everything, right? We all know that. We all nod our head. We listen to Gary Vee or whoever it is talk about take action, work in your business. And then there's all these other gurus that are like, just hire out and make sure you hire early. But let's be frank, is that one of the things that business owners, particularly the smarter they are and the more concerned they get with taxes, they start to be like, well, maybe I'll do it later. I'll do whatever. What happens is, folks, is you waste your time. And if you do the math on your time, like genuinely do the math on your time, as you become more successful, you are quickly going to find that you have got to free up capacity. Like, that's where I'm at. About a year and a half ago, it was like, holy smokes, I have to hire and I have to do this stuff. So people waste their time. If you're thinking, I'm going to DIY this stuff, I'm not here to convince you to call Mandy. I think you should call Mandy. I think you should go to ownitaccounting.com. But what I really think genuinely that business owners, and I mean real estate agents, I'm talking if you're just like an insurance guy that's getting paid 1099 from your independent insurance agency, we can do some massive tax benefits. We're talking about, this is a really loose scenario on $100,000 with the income. And that, you know, maybe that's aggressive, maybe it's not. That's, we'll get through the loopholes of like, we're not giving official tax advice to you. That being said, as your income increases, as your success increases inside of your business, that tax saving amplifies. So basically, not only are you doing that, but you're saving time and you're not wasting time. And then the last thing I'm telling you, folks, when you get somebody ahead of you that understands finance, when you talked about owner equity, when you talk about building some serious wealth, because you have to do that. You should have a wise person that understands retirement plans, that understands real estate benefits, that understands timing, bonus depreciation when those come out. They're in touch. Mandy's a CPA, and she's the type of accountant that understands what's coming through the pipeline. We have a new administration doing tremendous things. I won't get too political, but I like it when you have your money. I don't like it when bureaucrats take your money. And most of my clients feel the same way. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, not only do you have tax savings, but the second thing I think is that you have, when Mandy's helping you, they're so proficient, they're efficient, they're knowledgeable, and then they're going to be able to get ahead of things for you. So a lot of times, yeah, you might start by saving taxes. That amplifies as it goes. But really the big benefit is that you get a staff alternative. Like, they're just going to save you time, in my opinion.
Right. And that example that you use, the 95,000, that's a pretty much a baseline for a lot of my clients. We've got clients that are doing a lot more than 95,000. And I can guarantee you that if you're at $95,000, you are not going to be spending $6,800 on your accountant every year. I bet we could do it for, you know, a third of that. So there's a little bit of a trade-off, but you are still getting the net benefit of these tax savings, this tax planning methodology that S-Corp.
Yeah, I love it.
And also, you know, let's say that you grow your business and you have the insights and now you're doing $500,000 a year and you're taking a reasonable salary of, let's say, $120,000. Now the tax savings has grown exponentially. You know what I'm saying? So it kind of snowballs on itself. The more organized you get, the more proactive that you get with saving on the taxes, because that tax savings flows back into your business as either a retained earnings or it's something that you can pay yourself. But it helps you be able to grow your business and maybe buy that new piece of equipment or invest in that new training that will help you become a better real estate agent or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And the other cool thing about saving money on taxes, Rob, is that a penny saved, I say, is 1.333 pennies earned. Whenever you save money, the IRS can't tax you. It's basically like income to you that they can't see.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So that's really cool too. You're able to take that money and it's like after tax money, you're able to reinvest it into yourself or into your business or whatever that looks like, or maybe hire another person to help you grow your business. And now it's snowballing again on top of itself.
Yeah, because that's what a lot of people don't think about is that, you know, what's your gross profit? What kind of gross profit percent are you running? So if we save you, if you get $3,000, $6,000, $10,000 in tax savings, I mean, how many sales do you have to make to make that up? I mean, this is a bottom line saving. So that's what you're getting at, right? I mean, basically
I'm going to interrupt you one more time. There's this awesome quote that I love. It's from Jim Stack, I believe is the name of the author. He says, sales without profit is just more work.
So that's good.
Literally, like if you're not managing and taking a look at your profit margins, like if your profit margin is 10% and you save an expense, you would have to get 10 times as many sales to get the same net effect as just eliminating that expense. Mm-hmm. And most people don't even think of their taxes as an expense because it doesn't show up on your QuickBooks report. It's something calculated totally separately, and it's kind of pie in the sky for a lot of people.
Yeah.
But when you look at, you know, you've got expenses, taxes, liabilities, and retained earnings requirements, you've got to meet all four of those things to really grow and scale your business. And a lot of people are not in touch with what their effective tax rate was last year, and definitely not in touch with how much they can save going forward. I mean, if you save $6,800 a year this year and you save $10,000 a year next year, this is a permanent tax difference. It's not just like throwing money into a pre-tax IRA or a pre-tax 401k where you have to pay taxes on it later. This is a permanent tax difference, and you can save money every single year over the course of 10 years. That can really add up, especially as your business grows.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that we were talking, okay, so to summarize all that, what you're saying is that the S-Corp is probably the number one tool to maximize. And if I hear what you're saying, we're not here to pressure you into becoming an S-Corp, so you need an accountant.
Right.
Good businesses have accountants. They have attorneys too. And then they have marketers like me. But long story short, you're going to want an accountant eventually to make sure things are done right. Not only that, these taxes are a bigger savings than what you fully comprehend when you really let the finances sink in. But what you're saying is working with somebody like you to maximize this S-Corp is just one big puzzle piece in building tax-efficient wealth, in building a business you can grow. But I want to hit on this second thing. I want to pivot here. It's a subject that we talked about the other day, right? Mm-hmm. There's this QBI deduction, and then you also have some of these super tax-efficient retirement plans. Namely, you have SEP IRAs, simple IRAs, solo 401ks, and 401ks. Just so people know, if you're a single owner S-Corp, because we're kind of talking about these real estate agents, right? So I'm just going to summarize this. I'll hand it off to you because you're really good at teaching this. Long story short, folks, you're regular. Like, remember when you worked at a business and they would match you? You know, you'd put in $5,000 and they'd do a 4% match or whatever, right? The money that the corporation shot into that 401k plan is about the juiciest, best, most tax-efficient thing you could possibly give. And in a way, you're saving self-employment taxes. So that money from the corporation into there is called the employer contribution. Now, on the other side, you have the employee contribution. But employee contributions are coming after you've already paid those self-employment taxes. And then you have, everybody kind of knows, you have Roth or you have traditional. You're either going to pay taxes now, the gross tax deferred, that'd be Roth. And then when you take it out, no taxes.
Right.
Or you're going to deduct it. It's basically like a deduction on your income. But the thing I want to bring up here real quick is we know some people who claim to be fiduciaries, that claim to be in people's best interest, or they're even tax folks that get confused because when you have that employer contribution and now you have this QBI deduction thing, all of a sudden there's all this information saying, forget the S-Corp. You won't be able to put as much into your 401k, or you won't be able to do as much as a simple IRA, or you won't be able to maximize the QBI. I'm going to shut up. Why don't you help us understand this tension that's getting managed there about different goals and stuff? And yeah, go ahead.
There's a lot of tension there. And again, I'm going to give you that cheesy CPA answer that it depends. It depends on your scenario. It depends on your industry. It depends on the level of compensation that would be considered reasonable by the IRS for doing what you do. Like I said earlier, a surgeon might need to take a little bit higher of a salary to make the S-Corp worth the tax savings and also not get in trouble for only paying himself 20 grand. That's just not considered reasonable for a surgeon. But maybe if you're delivering bread, you know, on a on a truck route, that's a little bit different. So that's one of the things. It depends. As far as the QBI deduction goes, again, it depends. It depends on whether or not you're a specified service trade or business, an SSTB. And there's limitations. And it depends on your personal income level. So an S-Corp is a flow-through entity, just like a sole proprietor is. The money is taxed at your personal income tax rates. That could largely depend on whether your spouse makes $1 million a year or doesn't make anything. So there's a lot of factors at play here. And I say, you need to get a customized proposal. You need to find out whether or not this is going to work for you without just jumping right in and trying to do it all yourself without truly knowing if this is going to benefit you or not. And then as far as the SEP IRA versus solo 401k debate, again, it depends. The solo 401k is, I believe, a really good option for a lot of self-employed people. However, if you're wanting to max this out, the employer contributions as a self-employed person, if you have a solo 401k, you get to be the employee and the employer up to $58,000 for 2021. And so the problem that we can kind of run into with the S-Corp is that you're limited to 25% of your salary as opposed to 20% of your net business income as just the LLC without the S-Corp. So if you're taking a salary of $40,000 or $50,000, you only get employer contributions of 25% of that amount. So you're never going to be able to max out. And that's where you might look into doing the SEP instead, but you're going to have to take a good hard look at, is this really, you know, SEPs are pre-tax. You're not going to be able to do the 19-5 as an employee deferral. You're not going to be able to make that a Roth if you wanted to. You can do Roth employee deferrals as a solo 401k and then, you know, pre-tax for the rest of it. And that's probably getting a little bit more into the weeds, but again, it depends. You're going to need somebody like a CPA to take a look at your situation and combine that with your spouse's income and look at what state you're living in and how it affects the big picture and how it all fits together. And maybe it doesn't make sense for you to do the S-Corp. You're going to look at the proposal with those added accounting fees in there, the added S-Corp tax return preparation, the monthly bookkeeping, the monthly payroll, the added unemployment tax return. So there's an added layer of complexity that, you know, a lot of people don't want to get into because it just gets complicated. And that's where hiring someone to do all of this for you really helps. And, you know, I've seen it where the tax savings equals the added cost of the accountant. It's a break even. So it's like, well, why would you do that? Well, it allows your business to grow. And as you grow and scale, like I said, you have that snowball effect where in future years, you're going to have a lot more tax savings than, you know, you have this year. Maybe you're going to save $3,600 this year and you're going to pay someone like me $3,600 to manage it for you. But guess what? Now you have more time. You don't have to worry about doing your bookkeeping. You don't have to worry about paying your employees or your 1099 contractors. It's just all done for you and you're able to focus more on growing your business. So even if you're at that break-even point, it might be worth it for you from a time standpoint to bring in an accountant to help you. So those are some of kind of the different complexity and the different tensions that you might have. If you've got the solo 401k and you want to make the S-corp election, now you have a little bit of tension you're not able to max out. But in all reality, Rob, not very many business owners are even in a place where they can max out at the full.
Right.
So that applies honestly to a very small percentage, like some of these locums physicians, or you know, maybe some of these medical sales where they've got the $400,000 or $500,000 in profit and they've got the cash flow to throw the $58,000 into their retirement accounts every year. But most of us aren't even at that level yet. And that's something that can be revisited later if needed. As far as there's other strategies besides the 401k that you can utilize to help max out your retirement accounts. So
yeah, for sure. Again, but like this is a tension we talked about because we've met CFPs. I've met investment advisors. Remind everybody that I have a Series 7, Series 66 life and health that I let lapse, and I was in that investment world. You worked for a CFP investment advisor. We've been in firms that have all these different things. So there's a little warning here and there's a little piece of advice if I were to summarize it for dummies like me. One, if you're talking to somebody that's also doing your investments and your taxes, remember, they get paid off the investments. They don't get paid usually at all on the taxes. So watch out there. Number two, what we're saying is that as your income increases, you got these retirement plan tools to reduce your taxes. And if you're a little guy, if you're a single owner gal, you're a real estate agent, we would recommend checking out, and this is if you don't have employees, okay? A solo 401k, which Vanguard and Schwab provide. Just long story short, you can do up to 20% or 25% of your S-corp salary or your LLC net, Schedule C net profits, one of those two. Right, so it gets smaller with an S-corp, but you're not paying taxes. It gets bigger with an LLC, but you're paying self-employment taxes. You can do up to 20-25% in as a straight profit share contribution. So for those that are looking for a good write-off before the end of the year or to the extensions, an individual 401k or even a SEP IRA both offer similar things. So we're not giving you legal advice. You got to talk to an investment professional. We're not giving any advice there. But Vanguard is cheap. Good. I like it. I would highly recommend it. But what Manny's saying too, it's dependent on your goals. Some of these, when your income gets up, it's like, holy cows, I'm getting taxed at 52% when it's all said and done. Get this off my books yesterday, right? And that's where profit share plans, 401k plans, more benefits, fringe benefits. You've got all sorts of options to start. This is what rich people do. They pay accountants complicated taxes. But for most of us, nice little S-corp, nice little retirement plan can be really good. And what's cool about Mandy, genuinely, she's a CPA. You've been working in small firms and big firms. You've got a perspective. There's not a tax return you can't stare down and conquer or a tax. Like that's part of what I really enjoy about you in particular is that you've got that option. I do just want to show real quick. Just a real quick visual. Long story short, there's this maximum contribution you can make. And then it's you've got employer side, which would be from the corporation. You have your own contributions. And then it equals up to 52,000. Or if you're older, you get a catch up. But long story short, guys, work with a tax professional and reduce your taxes. What thoughts are you having, Manny? What else is coming to mind here when it comes to tax savings? Go ahead.
Sure. Yeah. You know, two of the other big things that you can do right now, if you're not ready to start the S-corp, just make sure you're keeping track of your business mileage and your home office. If you take the home office deduction and you're using actual expenses like your mortgage interest, your utilities, and you're taking that as a business percentage of all of your housing improvements, repairs, maintenance. If you live in a high cost of living area, that has a potential to be a huge deduction for you. And when you combine that with the savings of the S-corp, you're really going to be on top of it. Because tax planning and tax savings isn't just entity selection. It's also maximizing your deductions in real time. You can't go back in time and create deductions once the year is over. If you are looking at your tax deductions as they occur, it's really hard to recreate a mileage schedule on April 14th for the whole previous year. I mean, nearly impossible. And the IRS requires you to keep a log of your business miles, whether you take the standard mileage or actual auto expenses, with a pro rata for your personal.
What's the easiest way for somebody, just real, Captain Rick, the realtor, what's the easiest way to actually log that stuff? Because they're all over the place. How do you do that without just wrecking your day and getting stuck screwing around?
Just use apps. A lot of my clients use either MileIQ, Sherpa Share, which is made for Uber and Lyft drivers, but anybody can use it. And then QuickBooks Online actually is rolling out a built-in mileage tracker. And their software is getting more expensive as of this week, but I think that it's still kind of the best software on the market for that. So
we got MileIQ, you said, and then Sherpa Share for Uber drivers and stuff.
But you can use it even if you're a real estate agent and you're meeting people for, showings or whatnot.
So here's another question. I'm a real estate agent. I want to have a badass car. Like, I want a car that has, I just want to roll up and look awesome.
Right.
Help me understand.
G-Wagon or whatever.
Yeah. Talk to me about three simple ways. What do I need to know to maximize my vehicle write-off wraps? What do I get to write off? What don't I get to write off? And you don't have to get super specific, just top level, because I always get so confused on this. Isn't there a 6,000 pound axle limit or something? But how do I have a sweet car?
Sure. Yeah, there's the bonus depreciation that you can get on your vehicle. But there's also, just basic expenses like fuel, repairs and maintenance. If you're leasing a car, you can take, your monthly payments, or your interest on your auto loan. You can add up all of those actual expenses together, and then they get applied to your business use percentage, which is calculated as your business miles divided by your total miles. So if you're also using your car for personal use, you don't get to write off 100%, because obviously, not 100% of it is attributable to your business.
Yeah.
And honestly, that as far as the axle, the weight limit and all of that stuff, we can get too much into the weeds with that. I mean, the weight limit is the car when it's empty and not when it's loaded down with stuff.
That's funny.
I can't even believe how much detail goes into that, but. I would say that's something that, when you're looking into potentially buying a new car, to ask your accountant about, and having an accountant kind of on a monthly retainer is really useful when questions like that come up throughout the year.
Yeah. And help me out with this. Okay. The home office thing. So, to recap the vehicle, one, there's some bonus stuff if it's a heavy truck. Number two, you just need to make sure you're keeping good records on your mileage and everything, right? And number three, you should not be a financial fool and just buy a gigantic car because you want to, you still got to make profit. People forget,
go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I was going to say, you never want to spend a dollar just to get back a dime.
Yeah.
You never want to just go buy tax deductions, because you could have used that tax to actually grow your business. And instead you're just buying tax deductions, and now you have all this stuff that you may not really need, or that may not be driving your revenue. You want your expenses to drive your revenue. Mm-hmm. So if having that nice car really helps you drive your revenue and helps you get those clients that maybe need a little bit higher level of professional image, then go for it. But if it doesn't really matter to your revenue, to your top line, to your sales, I would say try to avoid just buying tax deductions for the sake of buying tax deductions, because you're lowering your profit for no reason at that point.
Yep. Amen, sister. I love that, because it is so funny how guys will chase. And I don't know why I say guys. Mainly it's because I will see these construction dudes all over the place. I know what their books look like. And it's that truck is more expensive than your house is, probably. Whatever. I get it. But now help me understand this whole home office thing, right? Is everything the same? Are there, everybody kind of had a home office deduction, but we want to talk to business owners, right? How do you maximize that? What are some important things to understand and help people understand how much am I get to write off my house? I get to write off my mortgage. What do I and what don't I get to write off?
Sure. And just to clarify, if you're a W-2 employee and you're working from home during this whole COVID thing, this is a totally different discussion. You don't get a write off for that, unfortunately. If your employer is reimbursing you for some of the home office stuff, you can look into that. But this is for business owners only. If you have a home office, you can, there's two ways you can do it. You can take $5 per square foot of space that you occupy. So like if you have a little, and it has to be used exclusively and regularly for business. It can't just be like, you know, the toilet or the kitchen island or, yeah. you know, your guest bedroom that you use for other things. It needs to be exclusively used for business. And so you get $5 a square. So if you have a 300 square foot office, you're going to get $5 times the 300. Or you can take your square footage of your office divided by the square footage of the total home. So like, let's say your home office takes up 50% of your house, which would be mm-hmm. probably way more than any of you actually have, but you never know. You might be running a huge business. You might be storing inventory in, you know, three of your bedrooms or whatever. Mm-hmm. So 50% of your mortgage interest is now deductible to your business. 50% of your repairs and maintenance, 50% of your utilities, 50% of your landscaping bill. Like I said, if you live in a high cost of living area, if you've got $20,000 of mortgage interest every year, you get to deduct half of that on your business side of things.
But not the principal, right? Not the principal. It's never the principal. Okay.
Just the interest. Or if you're renting, you get to take 50% of your rent if your office takes up 50% of your house. If you're an S corp though, it gets more complicated. And this is again where you'd want to bring an accountant. You need to have what's called an accountable plan. The calculations are the same, but you need to be reimbursing yourself from the S corp to your personal account for these quote unquote personal expenses. So, you know, the S corp is going to be writing you a check, but there needs to be this contract in writing. It's really basic. Mm-hmm. All it is a piece of paper saying, I agree to reimburse myself from the S corp for these expenses. And your accountant can kind of help you figure out how that works. So, yeah. There's that added layer of complexity. Again, you don't want to DIY this if you're thinking about becoming an S corp, because both of those items need to be run through an accountable plan, which can become disallowed if it's not done correctly.
Yeah, absolutely. That's cool. How about so the other thing I'm seeing a lot of people doing, we have all these real estate agents and fitness folks that are thinking about remodeling their home and doing an addition. Because, you know, housing is stupid expensive and it's just irrationally set up right now.
Right. And mortgage rates are so cheap.
Yeah. Are there any advantages to, like, if I was going to build like a home gym in the back, or, you know, for me, I'm thinking about building an office that's literally exclusively an office. How would that work when it comes to deductions? I mean, I got to pay cash for everything if I borrow against it. Like, just simply, how would that look like if I was thinking of adding onto my house for my business?
In simple terms, you don't get to deduct the entire cost of your improvement right away for your home office, but you can depreciate it over time.
That's cool.
That's kind of how that works.
Okay, cool. So for, I guess the last thing that I would really want to know about, so we've hit on the S corp is gigantic. That's a massive part of good tax planning, or just entity selection is really what you're saying, right? We don't run around and hit everything with an S corp hammer, but
it might be better for you to be a C corp. For a lot of small business owners, that's not the case, but it doesn't hurt to run the scenario analysis and see, you know, if that would potentially work better for you.
And then we got retirement plans. That's kind of the second thing, and maximizing that according to your goals. Number three, we just kind of had like the timing, right? So what is deductible? Making sure you're maximizing the deductions and the timing of those deductions. Because like you said, you can't do it after the year has ended. You need to be on top of this. So if you have questions about investing in equipment or whatever that is, working with somebody like Mandy will help you understand what do you get to write off right away? What do you have to have a depreciation schedule for? And then last is just this whole idea of your home office, your vehicles and stuff like that. What other last thoughts do you have about what is it that can help a business owner, entrepreneur, real estate agent, whatever that looks like, to mitigate their taxes, make their life look easier? Anything that comes to mind that we're missing right now, or what thoughts do you have?
Sure. You know, we talked about the tax deductions not being available to you after the year is over. However, in most cases, you can make retirement contributions after year end. But that, like, let's say that you want to contribute to your 2021 solo 401k, but you don't have an account yet. Obviously you can do that because we're still here, but let's say that you want to make contributions before April 15th of next year. You can still backdate contributions for the prior year, but the account has to be open by December 31st. So if you don't have the account open, you can always go ahead and open the account and just leave it empty. And then when the cash flow comes in next year, you can kind of backdate it for the prior year. Not very many tax deductions are like that, but that's one of them. And that includes extensions. So if you file an extension through October 15th of next year, you're still able to contribute for the prior year for your retirement plans, which is really cool. And that's one way that if you're kind of running into, I have this huge tax bill from last year, and I want to mitigate that a little bit, and I've run out of ideas because I didn't keep track of everything during the year. I don't have my mileage put together or any of that. You might be able to kind of throw in some backdated retirement contributions.
For sure. I guess last thing is, so if people are looking to connect with you, you make this pretty harmless. This is what I really love about you, and I've got a handful of other accountants that I trust all the way. I genuinely trust you all the way. It's not just because we have relationships and we do stuff together, but honestly, you worked with us at my old firm. When I got out of there, you got out of there, you've shifted through. You add so much stinking value to customers. What does it look like to get started with you? You know, if you were to just summarize it, people are apprehensive. Oh, I'm going to work with you. You sound fancy. You're going to be expensive. Just help me understand what your process looks like and what should people expect if they connect with you at ownitaccounting.com.
Sure. So it's the same process. You would book a free discovery call. It's basically a free financial checkup where we look at your prior year tax return and looked for missed opportunities and missed tax deductions. And then we also look at the current state of your bookkeeping and how you're keeping track of income and expenses. And if you're not keeping track of it, that's okay. We can still talk. And we kind of come up with a plan, a game plan to see, you know, maybe becoming an S-Corp is going to be the right thing for you. Maybe it isn't. But you have that free scenario analysis. And then we come up with a couple of proposals for monthly ongoing accounting services. So you have somebody on retainer all the time. You can ask unlimited questions to. There's no surprise bills. You're not getting billed by the hour. And we can help you really grow your business and scale your business. And honestly, I've been able to work with people who are just getting started and have quarterly accounting. You know, they might be at $15,000 a year revenue. I have clients at that level. I have other clients who are at the, you know, $1 million revenue level. It just depends on your scenario. We can come up with a proposal that works for you and your budget.
I love it. Yeah.
There's folks, really, there's nobody that can be left out of this. I think that for most people, you can start saving on taxes, whether you're big or small.
Mm-hmm. And I would just add, people, if you're at this point where you're thinking of adding an accountant or adding some help, okay?
Right.
I met so many business owners, genuinely. We went from zero to 150 plus small businesses in less than, like, it was like 2 years that I did that. And ironically, it was almost all in person. And what I learned was most successful business owners come around year three. They consider what I call Patty part-timer. And the idea is they're going to pay somebody $20 an hour to come in one day a week. It's usually on Friday to run payroll and to do some books. And if you do the math on that, over the year, that's going to cost you about $8,300. If you're thinking about
that,
yeah, and then you have your taxes, then you have your advice, then you have your bookkeeping software. I love, and it, like, genuinely, if you check out anything that I produce, a one-stop shop that includes everything is exactly what I love. It just makes life easy. And when you do the math on your time, when you do the math on staff alternatives, on the taxes that you'll save and the efficiencies you create, I'm telling you, even if you're paying, you know, $300, $900 a month, $1,500 a month, whatever that is, $1,500 a month is a much better situation for most small businesses than hiring somebody part-time that's not a CPA, that doesn't have a master's in accounting like Mandy does and doesn't have the experience. So go to ownitaccounting.com. Any other thoughts you got there, Mandy?
Sure. You know, if you're hiring, like you said, Patty part-timer, there's nothing wrong with Patty part-timer. I've worked with a lot of people like that. But if they don't have a background in accounting, if they're not sure what they're doing, you're going to be spending a lot more money when you send your books to the CPA at the end of the year because they have to do some cleanup.
Yep.
They're going to have to add some journal entries to get everything cleaned up. They're going to have to, when I file my clients' tax returns, I literally, it's already clean. I already know what to do. I just plug it in the tax software and go. It takes literally no time. It's like a slam dunk. People money on that end of things. You're not having to pay a CPA to come and clean up your books at the end of the year every year. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And you're not going to be able to hire somebody for a lot of my clients are spending around, you know, anywhere from $3,600 a year up to $12,000 to $15,000 a year. You're not going to be able to hire somebody for that. Not at the caliber of having a CPA looking at your books every month and giving you some advice on how to grow your business and helping you understand the profit and loss, the balance sheet, cash flow. You know, they say, you know, cash flow, that's the most important part of your business. And most people don't even know how to interpret a cash flow statement.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So we definitely have an agenda. I want you to sign up with Mandy. I want you to book an appointment with her. OwnItAccounting.com. Mandy, it's always a pleasure. We're going to do more of this. We got a ton of cool ideas. And I just so value what you're doing for small business owners. And I value our relationship. So thank you so much. And everybody, good luck. Check this out. We're going to have this on the...
I've known Rob for like almost 6 or 7 years now. And he's a really great guy. If you need any kind of marketing for your business, hit up Rob. I guarantee you he will grow your business and grow your bottom line and help you get where you need to go as far as your business goals are concerned. So just wanted to throw that out there and not make it all about me, because you do awesome work too.
Well, appreciate it. Well, thanks, Mandy. All right, guys, like and subscribe and check out the podcast. Take care.